everyone, Ben Coomber Radio, episode number 72. As you get this episode, I will be in Australia, hopefully tanning myself and not working, but pre-recording a fantastic show. I've got a very intelligent guy on the end of the line, far more intelligent than me. Like, if there was a scale of 1 to 10, I'm at 1 and this guy's at 100. This guy's from America, so we've got another different accent on the show today. Dr. Tom O'Brien, how are you?
Very well, Ben. Thank you for having me on your show.
You are more than welcome. I put a shout out on Facebook earlier on today, and there were like people were saying, "Oh, so awesome to have Dr. Tom on the show. He's influenced some of my learning. Great guy, perfect guest to have on the show." So I think people are going to love this.
Well, thank you. Thank you. We'll do our best.
We will. And our best is all we can do.
Yes.
So, I mean, there's going to be people who know you are. There's going to be plenty that don't know who you are. For people that don't know who you are, who is Dr. Tom O'Brien?
Aha. Well, let's see. I am a practitioner in clinical practice for almost 30 years, and now I travel and teach exclusively. I'm on the teaching faculty of the Institute for Functional Medicine, and my area of expertise in that venue is to teach about intestinal permeability, what in slang terms is referred to as the leaky gut. And I show the science with a lot of visuals and pictures so people can understand how when you get a blood test back that says that you've got 12, 15, 18, 20 foods that you're allergic to, you're not allergic to 20 foods. Well, you are because your immune system's responding, but it almost always, you can't say always on very many things in life, but this is almost always having an immune response to so many foods is secondary to intestinal permeability. And that's part of what I teach, but what I'm mainly known for is the world of gluten sensitivity and celiac disease and how a sensitivity to gluten will affect one's body depending on their genetic vulnerabilities. So some people, it affects your brain and your nervous system. Some, it affects your mitochondria and your energy, so your workouts aren't very good. Some, it affects your bones. For example, the Archives of Internal Medicine in 2006 said that they have no problem recommending that every osteoporotic patient is checked for celiac disease, as celiac disease is such a common cause of their osteoporosis. So I showed that slide to our doctors in seminars, and I said, "So doc, if the Archives of Internal Medicine says every osteoporotic patient just needs to be checked because it's so common, which one are you not going to check?" And when you get that kind of science, and I just do exact quotes from the researchers, and but doctors don't have time to read all of these studies. They just don't have the time. And so I do, and I read the studies, and I compile them, and I put it together in presentations. And I think the thing that I'm most proud of that I can tell you as to who I am, the British Medical Journal published a paper in 2011 that showed, it was a meta-analysis. And what a meta-analysis is, they look at many studies on a particular topic and they try to find a consensus amongst many, many studies on that topic. And what they looked at was translational research. Translational research is when someone publishes a new idea and it changes the way doctors think. It completely shifts their consciousness on a particular topic. And the average, in this British Medical Journal article, what they found, the average length of time between when translational research is published and when the doctor down the street is using these commonly accepted concepts, the average is 17 years. That's the average for all translational research. So, for example, when they discovered that cholesterol had something to do with plugging up your pipes and coronary artery disease, it was 17 years before the doctor down the street embraced that and began checking cholesterol. 17 years. That's the average. So I read that study and I made a declaration that's not going to happen with gluten sensitivity. People need to know if they have a sensitivity, how it may affect them. And so I interviewed 29 of the world's experts, the world experts. For example, I came to Oxford, England, last June, and I interviewed Professor Michael Marsh, the godfather of celiac diagnosis. And that was just such an honor to meet him. But in any event, 29 experts, and I transcribed all of these interviews into print, and we made slides for all of the interviews, and I put it all online for free. It was free for 10 days. All 29 hours were free. And then after that, people could download it for $97. And we had 115,000 people that watched the Gluten Summit.
Wow.
And 17,000 people wrote to me to say, thank you so much. This changed my life. I'm going to talk to my doctors about this. Now I know what to say. Thank you so much. 17,000 people. And so it's available now at theglutensummit.com. It'll be available forever. And you will hear from the world's experts about how gluten may be the trigger for Parkinson's or for multiple sclerosis or rheumatoid arthritis or chronic fatigue or poor athletic performance or osteoporosis or attention deficit or autism. And the list goes on and on and on. But you will hear it from the experts how if you have a sensitivity to this product that most of the world eats two or three times a day, if you have a sensitivity, that is going to manifest wherever your genetic weak link is. So I think that's what I'm most proud of, is that we've moved the needle, because I said that's not going to happen in the 17 years. And just 3 days ago, the Scientific American Journal, a very prestigious journal for the general public, they published an article 3 days ago, gluten sensitivity may be a misnomer for distinct illnesses to various wheat proteins. It's now common knowledge and commonly accepted about gluten sensitivity, and that there are many different peptides of gluten. That's what the article talks about. My pride in seeing that article is that 2 years ago, people said there's no such thing. Our researchers said there's no such thing as gluten sensitivity. Now it's common topic. So if I wanted to be introduced for anything, Ben, I think it would be the facilitator of theglutensummit.com, because people will learn so much there.
Wow. I mean, you've already affected a huge amount of people with that. I mean, 117,000, either way, a huge number of people watched that. And that is incredible. So hats off. But, you know, you've obviously got a huge and invested interest in gluten. And I find a lot of the best people in practice in the fitness and health paradigm, they kind of come through a kind of personal journey. You know, what got you so interested in gluten? What drew you to that being a focal point of your kind of learning, I suppose?
Oh, well, thank you for the question. There are two components to that. One, 34 years ago, and one much more recently. 34 years ago, my ex-wife and I could not get pregnant. And I was an intern at that time, still in clinic studying and in my internship. And I called the seven most famous doctors I'd ever heard of and asked them, and these were the most famous holistic doctors, what do you do for infertility? This was 1979. And they all told me what they would do and some things I'd never heard of, so I had to research and all of that. But I put a program together and we were pregnant in 6 weeks. My neighbors in married housing heard about it, and they had been through artificial insemination and nothing had worked. And they asked if I'd work with them. And I said, well, I don't really know what I'm doing, but I don't think it's going to harm you. And she was pregnant in 3 months. And so that got me hot to trot to get out into practice and help everyone get pregnant who wanted to get pregnant. And our daughter was born 33 years ago, and as a result, and what a lovely human being she is. And kind of a segue to that, I published a paper 4 years ago in the Journal of Practical Gastroenterology, Reproductive Disorders and Celiac Disease, and I just quoted 64 studies. And what you find is that recurrent miscarriages, unexplained miscarriages, intrauterine growth retardation, where these babies don't grow in utero, premature births, so many times when there's no explainable reason for it, it turns out to be a gluten sensitivity and celiac disease that's causing that. And you put these women on a gluten-free diet and they have healthy follow-up pregnancies. So that got me into it 34 years ago. And not that many years ago, this is a story that'll take a couple of minutes, but it'll give you a sense of all of this. I got a phone call one day. Aunt Emily is on the way to the hospital. She said, "What's wrong? What's wrong?" "We don't know. Some type of stomach pain." This is my godmother. And her health history was that she was in the hospital three times in her life for two natural childbirths, and then once for a car accident when she was in her 60s and broke a hip. So she's in the hospital for about, I think it was about a month. I'm not sure. She was never on any pain any medications whatsoever, except for pain medication for about a year with the broken hip. No other meds. She was 82 years old. She went to her doctor for a physical every year, and the doctor would say, "Emily, you're as healthy as a horse, but you have to stop drinking," because she had mildly elevated liver enzymes. And every doctor knows that you see mildly elevated liver enzymes in practice quite regularly with no other signs of a problem of liver problems. You check and there's nothing, just these mildly elevated liver enzymes. And so you say, "Well, let's watch it. Let's just wait and see." And my Aunt Emily would say, "I don't drink." And she didn't drink at weddings. I come from an Italian family. This is the Italian side of the family. And we'd toast the bride and groom at weddings. You know, we'd hold up our glasses of champagne or wine, and Aunt Emily would hold up a glass of water and toast with as much love and compassion and blessings as any of us. But she would lift up a glass of water. And after the bride would kiss the groom from the toast, we'd look over and say, "Hey, you old woman, you don't belong in here. You're not one of us. You're not drinking vino. You need to leave." And we'd go, "Emily, Emily, Emily." And, you know, because she's the matriarch. And she would say, "Stasito." I mean, shut up, everybody. "Stasito." We'd tease her because Aunt Emily didn't drink. Next year, she'd go for a physical. And her doctor would say, "Emily, you're as healthy as a horse, but you have to stop drinking." And she'd say, "What's the matter with you? I told you last year I don't drink." And the doctor would ignore it because he wouldn't know what to do with mildly elevated liver enzymes. Now, when you have mildly elevated liver enzymes are a measure of dead liver cells. And we lose liver cells every day. And we make new liver cells. So there's a normal amount that we lose every day. And as long as you're in that normal range on a blood test, everything's good. Your liver's healthy and functioning well. You lose some, you gain some. But when you have mildly elevated liver enzymes, it means you're losing more cells than you're making. And this went on for years for her. I didn't know anything about this. And then one day she gets severe abdominal pain. They rush her to the hospital. They find out she's got 4% of her liver left functioning. 4%.
Wow.
96% of the liver was completely sclerosed from the mildly elevated liver enzymes. So all the blood in the body goes through the liver. And now you've got all the blood in the body going through 4% of the liver. And in an 82-year-old woman whose blood vessel, she's a little frail like an 82-year-old normally would be, you know, but now all the blood's going through 4% of the blood vessels in the liver, but those 4% of the blood vessels are designed to handle 4% of the blood. Now they're having to handle 100% of the blood. They're being stretched out. And what happens to frail 82-year-old blood vessels when they're stretched out too much? They burst. The pressure is too great and they burst. It's called internal hemorrhaging. Oh, severe pain. They rush her to the hospital. They find out she's got internal bleeding and they do emergency surgery and they save her life. So I hear what happened and I talk to her daughter, my cousin, and say, "Cindy, have the doctor do this blood test, transglutaminase and deamidated gliadins." And she said, "Why would I do that?" I said, "Well, because it's a marker of a condition called celiac disease that may have contributed, maybe, to your mom's problem. Just have it." So I called my godmother every day when she came out of intensive surgery. And Emily, how are you doing? She says, I'm okay. And but she had 6 emergency surgeries over 2 months in the hospital. The blood vessels keep bursting. What are you going to do in an 82-year-old? You're not going to give her a new blood vessel or a new liver. And so they keep bursting. And they do emergency surgery. They save her life. So she gets weaker and weaker and weaker from the surgery. Finally, they say, Emily, go home. We can't do any more surgery. Your blood vessels are paper thin. She said, and they said, you know, you don't have much time. It'll be quick. You know, when you go, it'll be quick. She said, how much time do I have? We don't know. 2 weeks, 2 months. It won't be long. So they send her home. That's when I fly to Pittsburgh to say goodbye to my godmother. In the meantime, I called my cousin to say, sick of the 3 weeks that she's in the hospital, and said, Cindy, what happened on that blood test? And she said, oh, the doctor said you're probably a nice man, but you really don't know what you're talking about. So they didn't do the blood test. So I thought to myself, really? I have a few words for that doctor. So I tried to call the doctor, the hepatologist, as the liver surgeon, and he didn't answer. I got his voicemail, and I left him a message. I tried to be as polite as possible, not calling him an idiot, because he's a masterful surgeon, but he's not an investigator. He's not a physician that's investigating the cause of things. He's a surgeon, and he's the guy I'd want to do surgery on me, but he had no right to do that. And I said, doctor, you're a hepatologist. So I left him this message. I said, you're a hepatologist. That's a liver specialist. Do you read the journal Hepatology? Did you read in 2007 where Mayo Clinic published an article called The Liver and Celiac Disease? And they said that mildly elevated liver enzymes may be the only indicator of celiac disease. Did you read that article? Well, obviously he didn't. Or did you read where they said that 75 to 95% of these people clear up and have normal functioning livers within a year on a gluten-free diet? Did you read that? Or that at Mayo Clinic, all liver patients with abnormal liver biopsy, meaning they take a piece of the liver, they look at it under a microscope, abnormal biopsy with an unknown cause, they couldn't find a reason for it, every one of those patients returned to normal on a gluten-free diet. This is Mayo Clinic. Did you read that article, Doc? Well, he didn't. So they sent her home to die. I flew to Pittsburgh to say goodbye to my godmother. You ever said goodbye to someone that's known you longer than you've known you? You know, it's not easy to do. I stayed 3 days, and I get up early, you know, every morning. I went out in the living room, and she's in the living room. I said, and on the sofa, I said, Emily, what are you doing up so early? She said, I can't sleep. I said, lay down. And she looked at me, and that quick, she said, I'm too old for you. I just started laughing. And I said, I know, but if I can't have your body, I want your blood. Lay down. And I brought a barrel, a needle, and a tube. I drew her blood, and I called the local laboratory. I said, this is Dr. O'Brien from Chicago. Come get this blood now. And they did. She's a celiac patient. So the blood test was positive for celiac. So I had a meeting with the family that night. I show them the test results. I show them the article from Mayo Clinic because I had my laptop with me. And I said, Aunt Emily, this likely is why your liver got to the state that it's in and why those blood vessels kept bursting. You know, they told you your liver got killed off, and they don't know why, because you didn't have hepatitis. You didn't have any diseases that they could identify. This is likely why. So I don't know how long you've got. They say 2 weeks, 2 months. I don't know. But I promise you, you're going to feel better if gluten never touches your lips again. And so she said, okay, Tommy, okay. Uncle Mario, don't you make that pasta anymore. You make this pasta, because we're Italian, and they make their own pasta. And I brought rice pasta with me, and I made it that night. And it was, Tommy, this is good. All right, yeah, we can do this. Well, Ben, she didn't live 2 weeks. She didn't live 2 months. She lived a year and a half. A year and a half. And when I tell this story to doctors, can you imagine, doctor, what the hemodynamics, meaning the actions of the blood vessels, what must have changed in this 82-year-old woman that those blood vessels, those weakened blood vessels, they burst 6 times in 2 months when she was on her back in the hospital. They stopped bursting for a year and a half. Can you imagine what happened? No one knows because no one's ever researched this. But she lived a year and a half, no medications, no pain whatsoever. And I'd call her and, you know, from wherever I was, and she'd say, Tommy, where are you? And I'd say, I'm in Seattle. And in the background, there was always a crowd because the family was always at their house, knowing that Aunt Emily could die any minute. So the grandchildren came over and they said goodbye, you know, every time, and just, you know, kind of took it for granted. But they come over to do their homework. The daughters came over, cooked dinners. There was always people over there. The cousins were there. And she'd say, it's Tommy. He's in Seattle. And they'd say, tell him to drink some coffee. Because Seattle's known for coffee. Or next time I call, hey, Aunt Emily, Tommy, where are you? I'm in San Francisco. He's in San Francisco. Tell him to be careful. That they were always joking and in the background. And this went on for a year and a half. Somewhere in the middle of there, she called me and said, Tommy, I've got cancer in my liver. And I said, I know, Aunt Emily. How do you know? Well, it's common. That's what happens. Why did you tell me? Well, why should I tell you? I mean, you know, it's only going to worry you. And what should I do? I said, I don't really know, but I'll find out. So I called her oncologist. And I got the protocol they were recommending, and it took me 2 days, 2 full days of reading the research. I had to read some of these papers 3 and 4 times to understand what they were saying because I'm not an oncologist and I don't understand that field. But I finally got the overview, and I called her back and said, Aunt Emily, there's no evidence you're going to live a day longer, not 1 day. You'll be as sick as a dog. You'll throw up. You'll lose your hair. And I, if it were me, I wouldn't do it, but I'll support you, whatever you want to do. She said, really, Tommy, it's not going to help? No, Aunt Emily, there's no evidence it's going to help. So she didn't do it. And she didn't have any pain, but she kept getting weaker with the cancer. You know, I call and I talk, and finally they called me one day and said, any day now. So I immediately flew to Pittsburgh to find my godmother. She weighed 53 pounds. Now, I don't know what that is in kilograms. It's multiplied by 2.2. So, or no, it's divided by 2.2. 53 pounds, that's maybe 18, 20 kilograms.
Not a lot at all, basically.
It's what?
I said it's not a lot at all, basically.
Yeah, no, not a lot at all. And you know, she's skin and bones, and the cancer had eaten away at her. I'm sitting at the side of her bed, you know, and geez, I mean, whenever I tell this story, I just feel it. You know, my head's in her lap, and she's stroking my hair, and I'm crying. This is my godmother. And she's crying. And I lift my head up, and I look in her eyes, and she wipes the tears away from her eyes, and she says, thank you, Tommy. Thank you. And I'm sobbing. And then she gets this fire in her eye, Ben. She gets this fire in her eye, and she says, you tell him. You tell him. I said, I will, Aunt Emily. I will. That's why I'm talking to you. That's why I'm coming to England to speak next month. So that you understand that this epidemic affects so many people, and they don't know the reason that they get migraines, or they don't know the reason their child's diagnosed with attention deficit, or they don't know why they have chronic fatigue, maybe because of a sensitivity to the food that they're eating. They don't know. So my message is to give you the science so that you just look and say, my goodness, I just need to check. I just need to check. It would be very foolish to say everyone has a gluten sensitivity. But it's very rational to say anyone may have a gluten sensitivity and not know it. So I'm coming to England to speak on that topic and to tell the world. And I'm traveling the world, and this is what I do, is I talk and I teach. And the Gluten Summit theglutensummit.com, is the epitome of my work in the last 12 years. It's the accumulation of the knowledge in a way that people can hear for a very, very low price for 29 hours of these experts. So that's the introduction to who I am, Ben.
And it only took 25 minutes.
Yes,
But it was an amazingly beautiful story. And I think, you know, that's why I'm so interested in the gut as well, because when I was an obese teenager and I was trying to work out why I was overweight and tired and had ADHD and had eczema, it was because I was problematic to gluten and cows as dairy as well. And that was like the big key that unlocked my journey. And that's how I got in the health and fitness industry, by identifying these problems and basically reclaiming my health, so to speak. And I think the best practitioners have a story. And again, you have a beautiful story. And coming back to you having experience with helping couples get pregnant, I've had exactly the same experience. And it's the same as you. Like, you help a few people and they're like, oh, Ben, I don't know if it's a coincidence, but we've been trying for like 2 years to get pregnant. We've worked with you for 3 months and we're pregnant.
Yes.
And at first you're like, oh, that's really nice, congratulations. And then it happens again and you're like, congratulations. And then it happens three or four times and you're like, oh my God, like there's something in this. You know, we're just fixing people from the inside out at a deep rooted level, and things, funny enough, just work. And I think
exactly. Let me give you the mechanism behind that. One of the mechanisms, when a couple mates and the man ejaculates, there are millions of sperm swimming up the canal, and they hit the egg. Only one or two sperm get inside the egg. How does that happen? The sperm that hits the egg, as soon as it hits the egg, it secretes an enzyme from the head of the sperm, and the enzyme dissolves a little bit of the mucus of the egg, which is like a force field around the egg. So it dissolves a little bit of the mucus and it swims right in. That activates the genes inside the egg to close it down, and no other sperm enzymes will dissolve mucus. So once one sperm gets in there, and occasionally it's two, once one sperm gets in there, it shuts down the whole mechanism so no more can get in. That enzyme in the head of the sperm is completely zinc dependent. So when men have a zinc deficiency, which is epidemic in men, when men have a zinc deficiency, they will have normal sperm count, normal sperm motility, which is the only test done on men. You know, we're so chauvinistic in this society, we think it's always the woman's body that's the problem. So, but men, if they have a zinc deficiency, they're firing duds. And the most common mineral that's deficient in gluten-sensitive individuals is iron. The second most common mineral is zinc, because of the way it's absorbed and where it's absorbed in the intestines. So men commonly have zinc deficiencies, and zinc deficiency permeates all the way down to the sperm and the enzymes in the sperm. So the sperm hit the egg, but they're firing duds. The enzymes don't dissolve the mucus. They can't get in. They're infertile. And we think it's the woman. And when our OB-GYNs, our fertility specialists, do all their tests on women, they can't find a problem. What do? If they can't find an organic problem, they shotgun drugs into the woman. And sometimes they help, sometimes they don't. But it easily could be the male. And I've had three couples in my professional career. I didn't do anything to them except give the guy some zinc. I test them for zinc deficiency. You give them some zinc. And I've had three couples that within a couple of months, they were pregnant. So that's just one of the mechanisms, the science behind how a gluten sensitivity may cause infertility.
Wow. Nice. So let's explore a couple of other things. We know from the research literature that around 2% of people are celiac or test for celiac. Now, we find that it's not the case with a lot of people, because we know that there are different levels of severity in terms of gluten sensitivity. So there's an argument with a lot of other healthcare practitioners to say, well, gluten's not an issue because only 2% of people present themselves with celiac disease. So unless they're celiac, we don't need to worry about it. How do you kind of, formulate your argument against that with what is available in terms of the research literature and what we know.
Yes, thank you. And it's there's something called neuronal plasticity, and it's the goal for all of us, if you understand it. It's the goal for everyone as we age, is that we want our brains to be plastic, meaning pliable, adaptable, so that we don't get too rigid. Unfortunately, with most of our healthcare practitioners, there's a rigidity in their concepts. And it's because they haven't had the time to read the literature. If you read the literature, it's extremely clear that the people that are diagnosed with celiac are those that have an endoscopy, that's putting a tube down and looking in the intestines and snipping out a little piece and looking at it under a microscope. That's how you get the diagnosis of celiac disease. If when you look at it under a microscope, you find that the microvilli, they're like shags of shag carpeting, are worn down. I'll back up and I'll just, you know, the intestines are a tube. It's 20 to 25 feet long. The inside of the tube is lined with shag carpeting. This shag is where calcium is absorbed. This shag, vitamin C. The shag's over here, proteins. The other shag's good fats. All the shags absorb different nutrients. Celiac disease is when your shags wear down and you get Berber. And with Berber, you don't absorb nutrients. You get osteoporosis, or you get anemia, or you get any other, so many different conditions, zinc deficiencies. So that's celiac disease, when your shags wear down and you've got Berber. So the diagnosis of celiac disease, the 1% to 2% of the population that have a diagnosis of celiac, are those that have total villus atrophy, meaning the shags have worn down completely. And the studies are very clear about the blood tests. There's two blood tests that are commonly done. There's a couple of others, but the two main ones, and I'll talk about this in much more detail when I come over to England, but the two common tests are endomysium and transglutaminase. And the more common one that's used now, because it's a little more wide scope in identification, is transglutaminase. And the papers show 97% accuracy, 98% accuracy, 100% accuracy to identify celiac disease if these blood tests come back positive. So the doctors do the blood tests and they come back negative, say, no, you don't have a problem. Look, see, your blood test is negative. The problem is, and there are many, many research papers on this, you just have to read them. The problem is all of those studies that say 97, 98, 99% accuracy for this blood test, who did they check it on? They checked it on people who were celiacs. Well, that makes sense. But to qualify for a diagnosis of celiac, you have to have total villus atrophy. Your shags have to be worn down completely. It's the end stage of the disease. So the blood test is very accurate to identify the end stage of the disease. When they looked for earlier stages of the disease, with the shags partially worn down or before the wearing down process begins and there's a great deal of inflammation, when they looked at those stages, they found the blood test had a sensitivity and accuracy of between 27 and 33%. They were wrong 7 out of 10 times and came back with a false negative, saying that there's no problem when there really is a problem. So the blood tests that are done conventionally in Great Britain are very, very accurate if you're at the end stage of the disease. If you are at an earlier stage of the disease, you run the risk of 7 out of 10 people where it comes back and says there's no problem when there really is a problem. Now, there's new blood tests that have become available in Great Britain just since early December that are much, much more accurate, much more accurate. So you don't get those false negatives anymore. And that's why I'm coming over. That's a major message that I'll be talking about in the seminars.
Well, I, for one, will look forward to that. Coming back to the testing, when they test the transglutaminase, is it also a problem because there are several different types of transglutaminase and usually only one is tested for?
Good question. And the answer is no, it's not a problem because it's transglutaminase 2 that is the one that coats the shags in the small intestine.
Okay.
The other transglutaminases are for different tissue, like there's one specific for the prostate. Transglutaminase 6, which the test that has just become available over in Great Britain, also looks at transglutaminase 3 and 6. And six, I pushed very hard for that because transglutaminase 6 is a primary component of the blood-brain barrier. And if you have elevated antibodies to the blood-brain barrier, your immune system's attacking the blood-brain barrier. If your immune system is attacking the blood-brain barrier, you get leaky brain. Like leaky gut, you get leaky brain. And when you get leaky brain, it's a slang term and the doctors won't like it, but the general public understands it. When you get leaky brain, these larger molecules from the bloodstream get into the brain that are not supposed to. And when these large, because they can't fit through the cheesecloth that's covering the blood-brain barrier, these larger molecules can't get through. But when you have transglutaminase 6 antibodies elevated, you get leaky brain and these larger molecules get through. Then the immune system in the brain takes over to try to kill these molecules. They're an invader. They shouldn't be there. And here comes all the inflammation in the brain that is the mechanism behind brain diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and multiple sclerosis, attention deficit, autism, migraines, depression, anxiety, schizophrenia. And there are many, many papers on this. And I just show the studies. I show the studies and the quotes from the authors, because and the audience just sits there and goes, oh my gosh, I had no idea about this. So back to your question. Transglutaminase 2 is specific to the intestines and also to, it's a covering around your organs, like your liver and your kidney and your spleen. But none of the other transglutaminases have been identified in any relatively significant quantities in the intestines. So in terms of intestinal health, the transglutaminase that's the one to focus on is transglutaminase 2.
Right, got you. So when we know someone has an issue with gluten, obviously removing it is the obvious step and probably the most important step. What other things do people need to think about once they've removed the gluten? Because, you know, we're talking about a certain amount of damage has been done already. So what other steps do people need to consider?
Oh, man, if you could see me, I have a big smile on my face. You're asking that question. Way to go. Way to go. Because that is the crucial message that I'm carrying over there is you've been eating this food that you've just discovered is not good for you, and it's been causing inflammation for years. And wherever your genetic vulnerability is, you know, you pull at a chain, it breaks the weakest link. It's at one end, the middle, the other end. It's your heart, your liver, your brain, your kidney, wherever your genetic weak link is. The more you pull on the chain, the more likely that link is going to break, and here come kidney symptoms, or here come brain symptoms, or here come fatigue, you know, whatever your genetic vulnerability is. But it's the pull on the chain. And that's the inflammation. So you've discovered now this food that you've been eating for years has been causing damage to your tissue. And if you do the right test, you find out what tissue. But for now, if you just accept that it's been causing damage, so you stop eating gluten. My term for it is you stop throwing gasoline on the fire and you think everyone's going to live happily ever after. No, you've got all this damage that has to be addressed. It's been there for years building up. Well, a common phrase of mine is, if you're working so hard on a gluten-free diet and doing your very best, how many of you feel like $1 million or £1 million? And there may be one person in a room of 200 that raises their hand. I mean, honestly, how many of you feel your health is great, exactly like you want it to be? One, maybe two people. But they're working so hard in their food selections to try to be healthy. Why aren't they feeling like $1 million? Well, it's because they've got all this damage and they're no longer a 10. You know, here in the U.S., we have a term for the perfect body is a 10 on a 1 to 10. And people may be a 4.2 because there's been damage going on for so many years, or a 6 or a 7. And we all want to be a 10, so we stop eating the food that we've learned is bad for us, and we think we're going to, and we start feeling better. So now you're a 4.2, but now you're functioning at a 5.6. You feel much better. You're feeling 20% better. You've got more energy. You're sleeping better, but you're not quite 100% yet. This is why. It's because there's so much damage. You have to do aggressive nutritional therapy for at least 1 to 2 years to heal the damage. You cannot expect from the foods that you eat that you're going to rebuild. And the way that you can tell is by doing some tests beforehand to identify accurately what your current functional status is, not the standard CBC and chemscreen blood tests that every doctor does to see if you have a disease. Those tests are from the 1950s and 60s, and they're helpful, but they don't determine function. You have to do more recent tests that look at functional capabilities. All right, where am I? Where's my body functioning right now? What's my antioxidant level? How is my brain functioning? Do I have any markers of inflammation? You look for these other current markers, and that's your starting point. And it's not going to be good. I mean, when my patients, their test results come back, I'm as happy as it can be. You say, good news. Look at these tests. You're a mess. Good news. And they look at me and they giggle a little with uncomfortableness. I said, but this, here's our markers. Here's where we start. Now in 6 months, we'll redo these tests and you're going to feel much better. But now we'll have a marker to see if we're done or not, or if we have to continue longer. Because how you feel is not a good measure of what kind of damage is going on inside of you. It's important how you feel, but we have to do much more than just monitoring our treatment protocols on how you feel.
And I can imagine this tends to be quite individualistic, or do you tend to take a very similar approach with the majority of people, seeing as the damage is probably similar, you know, in most people in terms of what happens at the gut wall level?
That's a really good question. And there are some common nutritional protocols to heal the gut damage, but it's the gut damage for every one celiac that has damage to their gut, there are eight that don't have any gut symptoms. They've got symptoms somewhere else. The weak link in their chain is manifesting somewhere else. So you cannot just concentrate on the gut. The first thing is a well-balanced diet. You must choose vibrant, nutrient-dense foods. Primary importance. If there's only one thing you did, this is it. It's not enough, but this is a prerequisite first step. Then there are some, I call them shotgun approaches, that are helpful to begin with. For example, to heal the gut, there are some well-balanced formulas that include a number of nutrients for a pleiotropic approach, which means you approach it from many different angles. You don't just give glutamine. You give glutamine, but you don't just give glutamine. You don't just give vitamin D. You give vitamin D, but you don't just give vitamin D. You don't just give fish oils. You give fish oils, but you don't just give fish oils. My point is there are multiple products that are part of a common approach to heal the gut, but then you still have to get specific to where the weak link in the chain is and address rebuilding the weak link in the chain. And for most people, it's their brain, and you need more brain-specific nutrition. Could be your liver, could be your kidneys, could be your muscles, and you need more branched-chain amino acids to build more muscle, you know, things like that. But for the majority of people, evaluating brain function is a valuable tool.
Nice. So a couple of smaller questions. That was kind of the stuff that I wanted to extract from your brain, because that was the stuff that I was interested in. I put a shout out on Facebook, as I always do, and a load of people sort of chimed in and wanted to kind of get your opinion on a few things. So I've got a few small questions for you. I take it we're okay for time.
Yes, we are.
Now, good. This is something that I've also been quite interested in recently, because it was kind of a big topic 2-3 years ago, and it's kind of fizzled out a little bit. Guru Gill asks, vitamin D is a thought process I'm currently exploring, as I feel it's simply a case of, as I think it's not simply a case of taking some pure D3 drops in water to solve the solution. What's your opinion on effectively bringing up vit D levels when sitting in the sun is not an option? And should we also be considering vitamin A in this equation?
Good question. The answer of what we should be considering, first and foremost, is always best on test to see what your levels are so that you're not shotgunning. If you have the testing available, test to see. But in general, I can answer that question, though. Vitamin D, the world really profited from the discovery of another form of vitamin D called emulsified vitamin D back in the late 80s, I think it was early 90s, that it was absorbed much better than other forms, the standard form of vitamin D. Then later in the 90s, maybe in early 2000, came micro-emulsified vitamin D. It was even smaller, so it was absorbed better. Now, remember, with gluten sensitivity, the primary nutrient category that's malabsorbed, you don't absorb very well, are fats. So that's vitamin A, D, E, and K, and the fish oils. So many, many people with a gluten sensitivity need attention to that. Then about 6 years ago, I believe it was, a new form of vitamin D was identified or produced called micellized vitamin D. And with the micellization process, you take patients and you check their blood levels of vitamin D. You give them emulsified vitamin D, and you measure how much their blood levels elevate with a standard dosage. And then you give them a washout period, and then check their vitamin D levels again, and then give them the micellized vitamin D, same dosage, and you check their blood levels to see the impact of the micellized vitamin D. Consistently, you have a five-fold increase in blood levels of vitamin D when you use micellized vitamin D. That's why the products that we recommend micellized vitamin D whenever possible, is because you get more bang for your buck. Your body uses it so much better than other forms. Any vitamin D is better than none. It's important that we all check our vitamin D levels. It's much more important than checking your cholesterol every year. You should check your vitamin D level every year to make sure you have a robust level, not adequate. You want robust. And here's why. Receptor sites are like, I'm not sure the term in Great Britain. Please help me with this, Brent. But in the U.S., in the game of baseball, you have a catcher, and the catcher has a mitt, and the catcher's mitt. Receptor sites are like catcher's mitts, and the pitcher throws the ball to the catcher, and he catches it in the mitt. That's a receptor site. Every hormone that gets into our cells gets into the cell through a receptor site for that hormone. So your cells have, the outside of your cell walls have estrogen receptor sites, thyroid receptor sites, testosterone receptor sites, melatonin receptor sites, serotonin receptor sites. All these receptor sites are in different cells, and that's how hormone gets inside those cells. So if your tissue doesn't have a particular type of receptor site, for example, as far as I know, there are no melatonin receptor sites on bone cells. So melatonin doesn't have an effect on bones, as far as I know. But as a visual, anyways, an example, receptor sites are required for the hormone to get inside the cell. So thyroid hormone in your bloodstream goes along. It doesn't go into the estrogen receptor site or the testosterone or the serotonin or the melatonin or the insulin. It goes into a thyroid receptor site, which opens the door and allows the hormone to go inside the cell. Okay? There are only two receptors that are on every cell of your body. There are only two that have been identified. One is thyroid. Thyroid hormone affects every cell of your body because thyroid hormone is the thermostat on the wall in your cell. It determines how hot it works. In the U.S., you know, you turn your thermostat down at night and the furnace goes down to a lower temperature, you save fuel. And then automatically in the morning, it turns back up higher before people wake up and you set it for the time that you want. That's thyroid hormone. It controls the temperature in your cell. We call that your metabolism. That's controlled by thyroid hormone. Every cell in your body has a thyroid receptor site. The only other receptor site that's on every cell of your body is vitamin D. Vitamin D affects every cell of your body. That's why there are tens of thousands of studies on vitamin D with every condition that you can imagine. Because if you have a vitamin D deficiency, it may affect any tissue in your body. So you want robust levels of vitamin D, not adequate levels. You want robust levels of vitamin D. So in terms of forms of vitamin D, any is better than none. And the best that I've come across in my research so far is micellized vitamin D. And it's they're liquid. It's a drop. You put the drop on the tongue and boom, it's done. It's absorbed sublingually and it increases your blood values 5 times higher than emulsified.
Wow. I'm going to have to go and check the label of my vitamin D now to see if it's micellized. I mean, it's not something that I've heard about, so I'm going to have to read around that. So that's fascinating. Thanks a lot. I've always attributed this to thyroid issues, and you have just pointed out the body's natural thermostat is regulated by the thyroid. Robert Huskinson asked the question, runny nose and cold hands after eating, what could this be a cause of or due to?
Runny nose and cold hands after eating?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, if it's only noticed after eating, the first thing you ask is, what's going on in the gut?
Mm.
What's going on in the gut? Every healthcare practitioner, the old timer, you know, every practitioner that I've ever studied, the greats in the field, by the time they've been in practice 30, 40, 50 years, they all bow down to the gut and say, you've got to address the gut. I don't care what the symptoms are, you have to make sure this person has good bowel function. That means good digestion, good absorption, and good elimination. Critically important. So for that person asking the question, you've got something going on in your gut. And the weak link in your chain may be your thyroid. So that may be where it's manifesting. Thyroid symptoms are cold hands and feet, hard to get up in the morning, wish you had 20 more minutes in bed. Usually women wear socks to bed because their feet are so cold, or they comment their husband's feet are cold, or the wife's feet are freezing at night. You can't lose weight even if you don't eat for a few days. You can't lose those few pounds. That the metabolism, the thermostat's turned down too low. You're not burning enough calories. And even when you exercise, you don't get the results you should. Those are common symptoms. Depression, lack of drive. There are many, many common symptoms of thyroid function. But in this case, I wouldn't primarily look at thyroid. I'd certainly want to get an overview of it, but I'd look at the gut and see what's going on in the gut.
Nice. I agree. Right. Last question, and then we will wrap up and actually tell everyone where and when you are in London, and I will be there as well. Anyway, last question. Paul Burgess, who's actually someone who's on my BTN Academy, which we talked about before we came online, he says, what role does bone broth play in healing the gut, seeing as it's a key player in the GAPS protocol?
Bone broth is a very, very valuable component to a comprehensive, nutrient-dense eating style. Very comprehensive. The collagen in bone broth helps to rebuild tissue. It helps to rebuild the microvilli, the shags that have been worn down. I have not seen any studies personally. I haven't seen them identifying the genes that are activated in rebuilding tissue with bone broth. So this is from clinical experience. It would not be the only thing I would recommend, but we do recommend it with all of our patients as we're guiding them, some right away, but some it's too far out there. It's too weird for them. And so we have to wait until they've been on a transitioning eating style for a few months and say, you might want to check this one out next. You know, so you have to judge your patient and work with them according to their willingness. You know, some will dive in completely, some will dip their toe in the water, feel a little better, then they'll put their foot in the water, feel a little better, put their leg in the water before they're ready to dive in completely. Depends, but I think bone broth is a critically important, valuable tool, and it's inexpensive, and it should be a part for everyone's family. Back in the old days, grandma used to give everybody cod liver oil. Well, now grandma should give them all bone broth. And it's just so valuable, and I've never seen a downside to bone broth.
Fair enough. I was fully aware of bone broth in terms of you know, especially in injury recovery, anything to do with connective tissue and the muscle tissue. But, you know, I wasn't aware of its role in the gut and its healing. So for me, that's something I've learned today. So brilliant. So, Dr. Tom, like, let's wrap up this beast. Where are you in London in March and when?
That's really a good question. I'm not sure. I'll look at it here. I don't know. well, first, I would say there's two places that your audience might check out. One is theglutensummit.com. There's nothing like it in the world. I'm so proud of it. High accolades have come in from everywhere on that. I'm very, very proud of it. The other is our website is thedr.com, thedoctor.com. And there we have a link that says, "Where in the world is Dr. Tom?" And we list there all of the areas where I'm lecturing. And in March, I'm coming over to Europe and doing Dublin, Great Britain, Barcelona, and four cities in Sweden. And in Great Britain, March the 12th, I'm in Wokingham. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, in Berkshire. And that's at the Center for Nutrition Education Lifestyle Management on Wellington Road. And that's a 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. full day on food reactive disorders and autoimmunity. And that weekend, March 15th and 16th, being hosted by Dyn Health, D-Y-N-Health, I'm doing a two-day event. That's the big kahuna. That's going to cover everything. And that's at the Hotel Henry VIII on Paddington in London. So there are two different presentations over 3 days. March 12th is one day. March 15th and 16th is 2 days where I will be presenting.
Well, I will see you on the 15th and 16th because I will be coming to learn off you. And I think, you know, there'll be people listening to this that will do the same. I know there's a lot of personal trainers and keen nutrition geeks that will want to follow suit. So to find tickets for that, it's at thedoctor.com.
Yes, thedr.com.
Cool. And what tab will someone need to click? Is it under seminars, education?
Oh, thank you. It would be "Where in the world is Dr. Tom?" And it will list the location, and there should be a link that you click on, and it takes you right to the host's website.
Nice. Well, when I post this show up on Facebook and Twitter and stuff, we will direct people to the right place, so don't worry. That just leads me to say, Dr. Tom, thank you very much for coming on the show. It's been an absolute pleasure. I've learned something. I'm sure other people have learned some cool stuff too. I wish you all the best on your travels, and I will see you, and some people listening will probably see you, in March on the 15th.
Well, thank you, Ben. It's a pleasure being with you, and I look forward to meeting you in person.
Brilliant. Okay. Well, you, in the meantime, stay well, stay off the gluten. And we'll see you soon.
Okay, see you then.
Ciao.
Ciao.
So I hope you'll all agree that was an absolutely insane show. I'm staying on the line quickly, just see if I can help you out. So if you do want to get tickets to Dr. Tom's seminar, I will be there as well. If you go to thedoctor.com, so that's thedr.com, there's a green banner at the top. If you click on "Where is Dr. Tom?", that's in the middle, you'll then see like what is kind of almost like a Google calendar. And if you click across a month to March, you'll see that there are the details being hosted in London. And if you click on the date, it will show you how you can book. Hopefully, I'll see some of you there. And until next time, ciao. Hey everyone, Ben Cooper Radio, episode No Idea. I could be in Australia. I'm recording all sorts of stuff. I'm all over the place. But, you know, I've got a really different show today, and I really think you're going to enjoy it.